an audience. It's an honor to welcome you all to the launch of the report on Indian economy at $5 trillion. The economy grew from 1 trillion in 2004 to 2 trillion in 2014. The following 5 years saw unprecedented growth. We grew to 2.9%, with focus on innovation, manufacturing, digitization, skilling, and structural reforms. With the Government of India's initiatives and proactive emphasis on ease of doing business, coupled with inclusive growth, the Indian economy is projected to reach $5 trillion by 2025. The US industry has partnered in India's economic growth story, with the first two companies coming to India as early as 1902. AmCham and ORF embarked on undertaking a joint study on strengthening opportunities and removing hurdles to catapult India's economy to $10 trillion. That was our original target, making it the world's third largest economy. While this is an ambitious target, and while the economic pundits and media have been predicting a gloomy scenario with growth being down during the last few quarters, it is imperative to understand that the Indian economy is on a course correction due to structural reforms being initiated since 2016. The much needed reforms would be instrumental in more accurate data projections. India also has the opportunity of becoming a leader in the Indo-Pacific, with the capability of being a key economic financial hub as well. The current scenario and the unfortunate circumstances of the coronavirus has exposed the global vulnerability of existing supply chain and over-dependence on sources of supply. This is the moment to seize and synergize India's core competencies with technology-driven partnerships and propel India to be the key player in global value chain. AmCham and ORF have had extensive interactions with US companies operating in India and identified the opportunities across sectors to partner in India's economic growth story. Major thrust is required for development of appropriate infrastructure, road, ports, and air cargo. Another major challenge, which I'm going to leave Gautam to reflect on, are requirements of reforms in the land laws and also in the labor laws. The government has worked extensively in eliminating a number of archaic laws and reforms in the labor laws in tune with the rising 21st century need to be are awaited while welcoming the government's reduction in corporate while welcoming the reduction in corporate taxes and incentives, incentivizing new entrants, it is also extremely important to have a long-term tax policy. Sudden changes that we see coming up in the budget or also in our tax structure cause a major disruption and affect long-term prospects of the global investors coming in whose balance sheets go haywire with sudden import duties being imposed. To avoid the disruption, it is important to have continuous consultations. And we are delighted today to have with us Mr. Hardeep Puri, who was also gave us time last Friday, and who said he's got an open door policy and is willing to address challenges and issues that the industry would face. While the key parameters of economic partnership are dependent on this central government basically, during the operations, independent state laws are a challenge for the industry. Harmonization of business climate with certainty of sudden tax changes would go a long way in building investor confidence. So that is what we are really trying to bring in this report, and we are releasing it at a very specific time, before the visit of the US president, since US and India have been the longest standing and largest business partners. With that, over to Gautam.
Thank you. Minister Hardeep Singh Puri, Ms. Ranjana Khanna, and our valued guests. You'll have to excuse my throat. It's a little under the weather, but thank you for being with us this afternoon. It's my privilege and my pleasure to to take you through this report. Given that US President Donald Trump is on his way to India, we believe this report can set the business agenda between the two countries. It makes an assessment of what is and imagines what can be. The India-US trade in goods and services has jumped 8.7 times in the past two decades. This report argues that this partnership will strengthen over the next decade as India becomes the world's third largest economy, irrespective of Ms. Khanna's suspicions. We are definitely going to be the world's third largest economy. There are five key pillars for this India-US relationship. First, values. Through the engagement of the world's oldest and the world's largest democracies. This is more than a slogan. The constraints that democracy puts on countries, on leaderships, are equal. So there is a resonance, there is a democratic resonance of, there is a value resonance between the two countries, and the constraints that the politics of those two countries offer in making this relationship work. Second, capitalism. And this, again, is facing disruption in both the countries. Third, markets. Both are large and vibrant markets. India is a fraction, but still growing in the global stakes. Fourth, thank you. Strategy. Interests of the US and India are merging to create physical peace in the region and moral infrastructure for the future. Fifth, defense. And this is the merger of our strategic and economic interests through defense deals. As we know, the trade deal is not going to come to life until November, but the defense deal will be signed over the next few days. Taking these five as a background, this report argues that a stronger India-US relationship is inevitable. This preordained future rides on long-term self-interests as proponents of similar values. But these may collide in the short term as they are or seem to be due to transitory political or economic divergences. This report is based on a five-part exercise. First, a survey of CEOs of US companies in India to gauge their optimism as well as pain points. Second, face-to-face interviews with the CEOs to bring out the quality aspects rather than just numbers. Third, an analysis of the issues that they raised. Fourth, the business environment in which they, as well as Indian companies, function. And fifth, we make some recommendations for change. Some key findings surprised us. You will get to read the report as you go out. Please remember to carry a copy with you. I will go through just five of them. First, I think this report opened our eyes to what long-term really is. There is not a single company, single US company that is in India with a vision of being here for less than 5 years. 90.5% of the CEOs said that they intend to be in India for more than 20 years. The balance 9.5% are here between 5 and 20 years. So when we say that India and US interests are aligned with long term, this is what we mean. The commercial actors in this relationship, on which other aspects can be built, is one that goes beyond the present, looks beyond political dispensations, is one that and acts beyond the immediate. They see things we can't. They take decisions on what they see, and right now, what they see seems to look good. Second, growth prospects. Only 2.4% of the CEOs we surveyed said that they are not optimistic about the future of growth of their businesses in India. More than 80% of the CEOs said they were optimistic about growth. This seems counterintuitive given the slowing economy and the current gloom. But step back and place today's data in a wider perspective and we see how right they are. Sometimes I feel they are more optimistic than Indian CEOs that I meet. But anyway, third, infrastructure. While more than 8 out of every 10 CEOs said that the change in India's infrastructure has been positive over the past decade, which means across two political dispensations, which means the state of India rather than a political party in power, 2/3 of them said it still needs urgent attention. So even if we see a jump in quality compared to the rest of the world, India's infrastructure still lags behind. Again, this could be a function of the experiences of city dwellers versus plants in the interiors. Fixing this is a major challenge, but this challenge will also feed growth. Fourth, tax policy. 7 out of every 10 CEOs said that the change in tax policies over the past decade, again, across different political spectrums, has been positive. All CEOs were enthusiastic about the ushering in of the goods and services tax. They were accommodating about its teething troubles. I found that very surprising, because in other discourses that we engage in, we find GST is a burden. To American CEOs, it isn't. That said, we believe the government must simplify the GST and the problems in it. I must clarify that this survey was done before, it was done around August, September, which means it was done before the reduction of taxes on companies not seeking exemptions on corporate taxes into this survey. I would presume the number, as well as the percentage of CEOs having a positive stance towards India's tax policy, will have risen. Fifth, regulatory environment. Despite all attempts, 25.8% of the CEOs said that the regulatory environment creates hurdles in doing business, while more than half said it promotes doing business. Again, this may be counterintuitive, and I'm going to take you a little outside this report to give you some numbers which shocked me. But again, as veterans of doing business, it may not shock you. In the aggregate, there are 1,074 laws, both at the center as well as at the state levels, that govern doing business. There are 58,726 compliances that businesses have to deliver at the central, state, and municipal levels. There are 3,069 filings a year that they have to engage with. To put these data in perspective and make it come to life, I'll give an example. A large company that has 11 plants and 10,000 employees needs 163 licenses and registrations, has to follow 210 laws, deal with 9,500 compliances, and make more than 940 filings a year. That's about 5 filings in every 2 days. If you think doing business is difficult, what I see is that hurdles to doing business, or the laws and regulations and compliances to doing business, is in itself a business. And I'll illustrate with our American numbers. It's not that India is fighting over regulation alone. The cost of compliance in US has been estimated at $1.9 trillion a year. That's about 10% of the economy. I think both the countries, both the democracies, need to rethink the way this excessive compliance has been happening, perhaps for a good reason, but I think it is a major problem in doing business. Among recommendations, this report makes 4. First, manufacturing happens in the states, and hence state governments need to develop the enabling architecture to attract and retain US companies. This is already a work in progress as states compete to get investments. The understanding that investments lead to jobs, and jobs are as much political as economic, is slowly gaining traction. Second, roads and ports need urgent attention, as pointed out by Ranjanaji. Besides, there are last mile problems. For instance, getting water and power at the local level, getting that last mile connection, is one of the issues that the CEOs cited in doing business. Here, neither the central nor the state government can do much. The power vests with the municipal inspector. Third, land acquisition remains a problem. The process is long and cumbersome. This needs to be simplified. Given the political economy of India, that's easier said. But given the political intent, it may not be so difficult either. Finally, labor laws need to be simplified and made practical. Today, there are 51 labor laws at the central level alone. The government has begun work on putting them together into 4 labor codes. We believe more needs to be done. And why? I'll give you just one instance. The Minimum Wages Act of 1948 said that every citizen who works should get a minimum wage. This law is a central law, but is executed at the state level. Each state may have a different wage. So maybe you can look at about 30 wages in India today, is what you would logically think. But the number of minimum wages in India today is 1,915. I think this is outrageous. This is absolutely outrageous. We need to fix this. Stepping outside this report, through our continuing conversations with business leaders, we find that India needs to give up its narrow obsession with Make in India and expand it to make it more inclusive by appending Assemble in India. India does not have the luxury of looking down with contempt at any job that's created. If Assemble in India offers a compensation range of 15,000 to 50,000 depending on the skills, we cannot and must not allow such jobs to find homes in other countries. India must make place for them. A start has been made, and we hope this continues. Finally, although this report looks at American companies operating in India, the issues it raises apply to all companies in India. The opportunities of a large market are there for all, equally the hurdles. Before I close, I wish to extend my thanks to my co-authors, and if you could just stand up, I think they did most of the grunt work. Rukba, Rakesh, Tanushri, and Valerie from AmCham. Could you please stand up? Thank you very much for all your support. We are very grateful to you. I will close with an anecdote that occurred in the course of one of the interviews. One CEO told me that he gets a sense that the Indian state, not the government, the Indian state, does not like US companies. I told him that's absolutely incorrect. The Indian state does not hate US companies only. It hates all companies, all wealth creators, all entrepreneurs alike. The Indian state is an equal opportunity hater. This perception needs to change if India is to reach $5 trillion by 2025 and $10 trillion by 2032, which are the stated objectives of this government. Thankfully, change is in the air. Political intent is alive. We can see it, we can perceive it. Hopefully, policies and their executions will follow. Rent seeking will end. With these words of optimism and hope, I now invite Minister Puri for his comments.
Thank you, Ranjana. Thank you, Gautam. I'm glad that as the lead author, you acknowledge the work of your co-authors. I just had the feeling that they did most of the work, which you acknowledged. But I've actually taken the trouble of going through the report, and let me start by saying it's a very positive contribution. Any report which is based on feedback from CEOs who are operating in a particular environment must have some salience, and I think this report points in the correct direction. But what I must make a few introductory comments before I dig into the report. First of all, I've had the privilege of dealing with the bilateral relationship with the United States over an extended period of time. I see another colleague here who has had not as much experience as I, but a long experience as well. Look, in the interest of full disclosure, I spent 4 decades in another profession, and most people in that profession called diplomacy have the privilege of dealing with the United States. But I had a more direct hands-on experience. Fairly early in my career, I was inducted into the select group of people who get to deal with trade policy. So in 1981, I found myself in Geneva, and we were then dealing with contentious issues. They appeared important then, but with the benefit of hindsight, one realizes how insignificant those were and that the trajectory of the relationship goes ahead. During the course of your introductory comments, you used the word inevitable or inevitability, and I'll come to that in a minute. And in 1981, we decided to take the United States to the dispute settlement machinery of the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade because India was denied the benefit of the injury test on account of something that we didn't do or we were required to do. And if the case had come before the dispute panel, we would have won it hands down. But in a spirit of pragmatism, we decided to do a bilateral deal, if I may use that word, deal is not a word which is normally looked on very favorably by the purists. But let me say, we came to a practical arrangement. And we signed an agreement on what the Indian practice of cash compensatory support, which was the prevailing subsidy, which involved the restitution of indirect taxes, what it was. And the United States and India agreed that India would continue to provide cash compensatory support as long as this was required in keeping with our development and competitive needs. And I think that 1981 understanding, which is not very well known, sums up the fact that when you are dealing with two large entities, economically not equal, one today is a $21 trillion economy and we're a $2.91 trillion economy. So clearly when you appear, when you look at the issue of trade, in some areas you will look at it, if you're a part of a $21 trillion economy ecosystem, you look at it purely in trade terms. Whereas if you have the privilege of being democratically elected and you have to look at what the impact of trade policy will be on the livelihood issue, you begin to have to worry about little things. Even the preamble to the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, which was signed in, well, I think in mid-40s, all these arrangements came into being when the Second World War was still going on. It talks in terms of entering into mutually beneficial trading arrangements with a view to raising the standard of living. So I think in any discussion on trade, and I have the privilege of also being a minister in the Minister of State in the Commerce and Industry Ministry, I think any democratically elected leader would be displaying, I would say, dereliction of duty if you did not factor those things in when you are entering into a trading arrangement. Now, why is it important for us to work on this relationship, and why is it important? And you mentioned a figure about what it has grown 9.8 times in the last 8.7 times, sorry, in the last two decades. I have these figures here also. But look, I am convinced that no matter which way you look at the evolution of either the multilateral trading system or the fundamental trends in the global economy, these two countries, one a $2.9 trillion economy, which, you know, our critics, including those at book reviews who give sometimes semi-educated a comment, it is going to be a it's going to be a $5 trillion economy. It doesn't matter whether it's going to be by 2024 or 2025 or 2023. I mean, if you just look at the underlying forces at play, and I agree with you, I mean, rather, this is a Government of India stated thing and you quoted it, it will be a $10 trillion economy by 2030. Now, let me come to some basics on which there could be an interpretational issue. One is the slowdown issue. And I had the privilege of addressing another meeting which Ranjana invited me to the other day. And I keep telling my friends, including some very eminent students of that dismal science sitting here, tell me which country in the world, name me a country in the world which has had 11 years of continued expansion and then is undergoing some form of course correction. Now, that course correction may be on account of the fact that the global environment within which you operate may not be as benign. It is undergoing some, fundamental disruptions. Or it may be due to the fact that your own internal thing is cyclical and structural. So it doesn't matter. But it also doesn't matter whether you choose to call it a slowdown, you choose to call it a course correction, but to suggest that, we are in denial on that is, I mean, I think needs to be dismissed with the, contempt that it deserves. Let me explain to you why. Much of our comments today, including, I think, on the bilateral relationship, overlook fundamentals. Let me deal with two of the sectors with which I am more familiar with than others. And I come back to my own sector, which is housing and urban affairs, and civil aviation. Let me start with civil aviation. Look, today India is the third largest domestic civil aviation market. In the month of December 2018, somewhere starting from December 2018 to April of 2019, one of our largest air carriers ceased operations. The domestic comment and the comment in the outside world was that this is a very serious development. I'm not doubting that it is, but from that comment on seriousness of the situation, there was a hop, step, and quantum jump to doomsday scenario. Indian civil aviation is collapsing, this will happen, that will happen. Well, I want to fast forward. The number of aircraft in the Indian skies at that point of time was 650 or so, I mean, at the peak before it went down. Today, we are already at 760. We are adding two aircraft every week. One of our air carriers has 300 aircraft on order, and so on and so forth. My secretary in the Civil Aviation Ministry, who's a conservative, not conservative in the political sense, but bureaucrats tend to be risk averse and they tend to be cautious in their pronouncements. He uses a figure of Indian civil aviation fleet being 1,200 in the coming short to medium term scenario. Since I made a transition from being a cautious civil servant to being a somewhat reckless, within quotes, comparable and in terms of accepted definitions of, I say this not 1,200, we are going to 2,000 aircraft. We have a 435 million passengers throughput in our airports. Delhi Airport, when I joined the Indian Foreign Service, used to take 1 million passengers a year. It used to be called Palam International Airport or something like that. Today, Indira Gandhi International Airport has a passenger throughput of 70 million. From 1 million to 70 million. The world's largest airport hub is Heathrow, which has Heathrow, Gatwick, Stansted, I think, and it does 140 million. I'm not a betting man and I don't have too much money, but if I were, I would lay a wager that in the coming 5 years, India will be bigger than the Heathrow network. The airport operator in Delhi tells me that with the fourth runway, he'll already be bursting at the seams at 100, 125 million. With Jewar, six runway airport coming up, while which the land acquisition is taking place, between Jewar and Delhi will be way past 140 million. If you look at the civil aviation scene overall in India, Mumbai already does 50, 55 million passengers with new Mumbai, Navi Mumbai coming up, etc. That's one clear aviation hub which is staring you in the face. Kolkata, thanks to what one Indian, which is our largest domestic carrier now, they've already converted Calcutta into a hub. If you look at the flights from Calcutta to China, to East Asia, you know, etc., it's a major hub. If you look at Delhi, what it's emerging, between Delhi, Indira Gandhi International Airport, India, you've got another major hub operating here. And then take your pick between Bangalore and Hyderabad, you've got these four huge hubs. And I don't want to talk about the past. I don't want to say what we did right or we did wrong. But I think many of our own failures reflected in the growth of artificial thing. I'm not going into civil aviation. I'll tell you, when we had in international trade in textiles and clothing, we had a derogation from the free trade rules of the GATT. It used to be called a multi-fiber arrangement, where trade was not allowed to take place as per free trade principles, but it was regulated through a derogation of those free trade rules called the multi-fiber arrangement, which happens that countries were under quota. Because we were under quota, artificial textiles and clothing industries sprung up all across around India. Well, that's what the international community can sometimes do. I don't blame the community. We were part of it. We should have negotiated. But I tell you, in civil aviation, we are looking at 200 airports, rather than the 100 we have now. We are looking not at 435 million passengers. We are looking at 1 billion passengers. And we are not looking at those little things which come with bilateral agreements. We are looking at quantum jumps. If that isn't economic growth, tell me. with 7% penetration, which means out of every 100 Indians, only 7 fly, we were doing a 17% rate of growth. I don't like to argue with my friends who, having spent a little extra time in the service of the nation abroad, come back to you and without understanding what the fundamentals are, they start arguing with you. And because I was like that myself, and I count myself as one of them. Let me ask you a question. One major airline system stops operating. Doomsday scenario, civil aviation is collapsing. Today, I take the figures prior to the cessation of operation. I go back to November of 2018. Jet Airways was fully functional then. And I compare the figure of November 2018 to the figure of November 2019. Gautam, rate of growth 11.3%. Anybody who can do an 11.3% rate of growth on civil aviation at a time when a major airline system has ceased operation, that's not an economy I would worry about, because that's not an economy which is showing signs of slowdown. That's an economy which is in a phase of rapid and aggressive adjustment. Let me come to another part of my portfolio. I mean, one of the portfolios I deal with independently, public transport. We've been told that the Indian automobile industry is in deep trouble. That's what we've been told. That's what some of you may want to tell us. Why? Because car orders are down, this, that, and the other. If you actually analyze it in a disaggregated sort of a manner, you don't think it's correct, because some guys are selling a lot of cars, including high-end, whatever you call luxury cars. But I just say two things to you. It is not the car industry which you look at if you're looking at an economy. You're looking at public transport. Cars are important. And some of these may be business decisions. Maybe there are newer models or whatever. When I was inducted into the Council of Ministers, the average daily ridership in Delhi Metro was 24 lakhs per day. Today, the average ridership in Delhi Metro is 65 lakhs a day. Take that figure, store it at the left top side of your graph, and then just take the Ola and Uber figures. Okay? And what are you complaining about? My metro ridership has gone up from 24 lakhs a day to 65 lakhs. Ola, Uber are showing rise like that. And all that the car industry suffered, 1.6% decline. And that also they are making up in order. Is this an economy in slowdown? Or is this an economy in a rapid adjustment phase? I could give you figures on housing and urban affairs other than transport. I took public transport because I was talking about civil aviation. Look, in the 10 years between 2004 and 14, the total expenditure on urban areas, and now let me define this very carefully. By expenditure on urban areas, I mean only the amount of money allocated for the flagship programs, or what we call the programmatic interventions of the central government. Okay? In 10 years, it was Indian rupees 160,000 crores. In 10 years. Which, in US dollar terms, comes to $22.45 billion in a 10-year period between 2004 and 2014, which were the years of the the years of high growth, as the book is called. 10 years, 22.45 billion. In the 5 years from 2015 onwards, which is the time when Mr. Modi's government started its programmatic intervention through the flagship urban program, the figure is Indian rupees 960,000 crores. In less than 5 years, the figure is 960,000 crores as against 160,000 crores in 10 years. Or other words, US dollars 134.71 billion. There's no comparison. I don't know what is this high growth and etc. Look, your basic problem, and I keep repeating this even to the point where I am now beginning to wonder why I should keep on repeating this. Your problem is of measurement. Three of the largest sectors in the economy, agriculture, construction, and textiles and clothing, are in the informal sector. So any gray you can get up and you can pick up a pair of statistics and accept those to be correct. And then you backwards, forwards, and you come up with a narrative. I'm not suggesting that the commentary which is provided is contrived or it's fake. No, I'm just saying get a proper understanding and you'll see. Why am I saying this to you? Because I believe American companies operating in India, and Gautam, I read the report slightly differently from you, how you did, and I'm going to pick and choose those parts. And I think this report provides testimony, if anywhere needed, that the business environment within which you are operating in India is very, very positive in many respects. It requires attention in others. And we are alive to it more than that. The World Bank Ease of Doing Business Index, again, provides evidence of that, where you come down from 152 to 25 or 30, or in some areas, online business construction permits. My God, you've gone from nowhere to being in the top 5 or 10 in the world. That's the point I'm trying to make. Let me move from here to some of what we are doing, just to give you an idea, in terms of one project called the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. When the Prime Minister was elected in May 2014, he said it was his dream, he used the words sapna or sankalp, that every Indian should have a home which he or she can call their own. The title of the home should be in the name of the lady of the house, gender empowerment, and also it should be built to modern ecological sustainable standards. My ministry, much before I came, did a demand assessment, and we realized we had to build 10 million homes in order to fulfill that dream of the Prime Minister's. Look, in the month of December, a committee which is called the Committee for Monitoring and Sanctioning of Projects, it sanctioned 1 crore is 10 million. In the month of December, they crossed the figure of 10.03 million. We did a demand assessment some time ago. We said, well, it's not 1 crore, but 11.2 crores that will be required. And I'm telling you, by the end of this month, I'll have crossed 11.2 crores. 10 million homes to be constructed, or through different verticals organized, by the year 2022. We're only in 2020 beginning. This is the kind of work, this is the kind of economic opportunity that presents itself. I'm going to fast forward and then move on in another direction, come to your report. Let me tell you what we are doing in Delhi. Delhi's population in the year of the Lord 1947, when we became an independent country, was 8,800,000. The first Indian census was in the year 1951. And in 1951, the Delhi population was shown at, I think, 21 lakhs. Why? Because 13 lakh refugees came in after the partition. The next census will be in 2021. What do you think the population of Delhi is going to be like? Well, take a guess. I think it'll be anywhere in excess of 2 crores. Now, I'll just conclude with this one statistic in Delhi. You can fall for a narrative which defines development in terms of freebies, or you can look at the hard facts. The hard facts are that out of the 2 crore people who live in Delhi, 80 lakhs, 76 to be precise, will have new homes because of something called land pooling. 40 lakh people will get new homes on account of what is called the regularization of unauthorized colonies or Malkana Haq, that is ownership rights. And 10 lakh people will get Jahan Jughi Vahi Makan, or what is called under the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, a vertical called in-situ slum rehabilitation. So you have a population of 2 crores, out of which 1.30 crores are in the process. Anybody who follows me on social media knows every morning I put out 4 or 5 people standing in front of a camera with that conferment of citizenship there, and they're saying, well, it took 40 years, but we finally got it, and so on. Why do I put the statistic out? Because sometimes democracy is a fascinating system. It is fascinating because you are able to devise systems, instruments. You know, in the old world, journalism, if you had somebody who's called a sub-editor, he would at least have to check ye kaun article likh raha. And you would have an editor to whom you could say, but social media is fantastic. You can put out anything in the morning, and my God, it can go viral. It may have no basis in fact. So I said, well, let's drive this home. Because when I started this, I was told that, look, this is just a piece of paper. No registry has been done. I said, wait a minute. These guys have paid conveyance charges. These guys have paid stamp duty. No, this is not true. Why? Because somebody who has not done his or her homework called somebody and he said, yeah, somebody is saying that they have done conferment of rights. And they kuch nahi aise hi bolte hain. Khatam, he wrote a story on it. 2 years ago, or rather 2.5 years ago, when I joined the Council of Ministers, I reviewed the, and I'm an old Delhiwala. I was born here. I was educated here. I asked people, what is happening to this unauthorized colonies? I'm only mentioning this to you here because construction is a major area for economic opportunity. I mean, I was looking at a report today which says who's getting cake or the lion's share of the funds which are going on housing financing. So, I mean, I'm just pointing in that direction. Very interestingly, I couldn't find too many people who even knew what the basics were. So I was using a safe statistic that till the Supreme Court in Suraj Lamps versus Union of India said that, so, you know, the whole of Delhi property has been bought and sold on power of attorney. I mean, the Supreme Court said this can't be done. You need to change the system. So I was saying in Parliament that I am sure that at least since 2006, there has been no regularization of unauthorized. Somebody came to see me the other day and gave me documentary evidence. It's not since 2006. It's since 1993, nothing has been done. Not a single property has been registered. This is what is happening now. So I'm telling you the sea change which is taking place here. From all the slums and completely unregulated areas, we have sewage pipes and water pipes intermingling. When our roads are completely destroyed, that is the change taking place here. And I'm going to cap it all. There's something called the Central Vista Project. Again, I have some of my friends, without knowing what's happening. Look, every 100 years, somebody has to take charge and define what a city is going to look like. Delhi in its present form, quite apart from the 7 times when outsiders did it, the current Delhi governmental infrastructure, the Rashtrapati Bhavan, North Block, South, was built in 1913 onwards to, you know, 1920 something. We are paying 1,000 crores of rent to house government building. We have the land. So there's no reason why we can't do it in an architecturally aesthetic way, preserve the heritage, etc., and create a new Delhi. Look, I've given you these statistics to say that a lot of people talk about India without, I would respectfully submit, a more than minimal knowledge, without even more, it's just very basic knowledge. I now want to come to your report. I must say, I enjoyed reading it. When he asked me in this morning, have you read the report? I said, not only did I read it, but I asked my young colleague, incidentally, who's been poached from ORF also, but that's a different matter. And I
think more than one colleague.
No, only one. The other one's gone. Well, I'm ready to take on more. No, so what I'm saying is I read the report, but I read the positives. Look, the report deals with 7 components that impact the issue of ease of doing business, presence of quality infrastructure, ease of land acquisition, taxation policy, quality of bureaucracy, corruption in the government system, telecommunication facilities, availability of skilled labor. I'll just give you my notes, or rather my researcher's notes, after a discussion on what the report says. In quality of infrastructure, 82% of the CEOs believe that the change is positive, and this is a change coming to the quality of infrastructure in India. It notes the main obstacles to infrastructure development in India: political and regulatory risk, which you are talking about, access to financing, and macroeconomic instability. I don't think there can be any disagreement on that. When you look at the positive change taking place, it's essentially, and I make this point to my young authors, it's essentially a question not of comparing it to other countries. It's a question of comparing it to before and after. Where did you start and where did you reach? Why am I picking on airports? Because that is what it is. Today, as civil aviation minister, I get the maximum number of demands. Every village wants its own airport. And that's literally true. I mean, we can't, but we're going to get 200 airports. We have 100 plus 47 operating. We're going to have 250 plus operating in about 3 to 5 years. There's something called regional connectivity, etc. So infrastructure, ports, this, that, you look at that. A CEO essentially looks at business in terms of what it is in that infrastructure which impacts on his or her commercial decisions, okay? Here again, I want to point to things which are, which if you were to research those separately, those would be very positive addendum to this report. Look at the new logistics policy which we are trying to work out. Look at what we are trying to do in terms of, and Udaan is a very well-known scheme, regional connectivity scheme, but what we are doing with Krishi Udaan, for instance. So if you look at all that, you see that if you compare it to what was before and what is now and what is where it's going, it's a sea change. By the way, getting seaplanes also, seaports and rivers and so on. So it's a very different land acquisition. Look, the fact is that land in India is a state subject. And therefore, much of the frustration which I often encounter is that no matter what policy you frame here, land is a state subject. Now, you have to essentially deal with. And I think the World Bank rep here, the another meeting I attended before I became a minister, made some very valid point. He said, on the one hand, you have conceptually competitive federalism here. States are vying with each other. States are offering incentives, etc. But some of the issues that the report, I think, is trying to grapple with, even if it's not addressing those upfront, is the other residual problems arising from that. And I think there again, you know, issues like fragmented ownership of land. I just talked about land pooling. I mean, and you come up with an innovative method if you've got fragmented ownership. Earlier, we were toying with the idea that somebody would say that you transfer the title to the DDA. It's not going to work. In our kind of system, it's better you leave the title in the hands of whoever has a title and then work out a system where this fragmentation is overcome through pooling. Excessive negotiations with landlord, lack of basic, look, I think we've resolved that. I mean, very soon you'll see a new rental policy out. We'll be able to, you see, it's a very interesting situation. A lot of people don't want to give their properties on rent because they think that if you have a weak legal system, you might not get your property back. I think we've overcome that. We've overcome that. Now when you have a rental policy in place, when you will have one in place, we've already got the template, etc. States can tweak it to the extent that they like. You will have a situation where large amounts of residential accommodation, which is not being utilized, will then be released into the market, and that's the kind of... taxation policies. I think I'm just going to take what you said. I think this was written before the changes came in. I mean, you've got, I mean, there's one thing if I were a student of India looking at India from the outside is that this is a government which is ready to see what change is required and then it's got no hang-ups in going in and effecting that change. I mean, you've come from what, 46% corporate tax rate down to one of the lowest in the world. So there's no inhibition on that. So I'm going to skip taxation policy, bureaucracy. Look, I think what the report acknowledges, I don't know how explicitly, is that when you're dealing with the policy framework and you're dealing with the senior bureaucracy, you don't have a problem. The problem comes down the chain when you're dealing with people, like in Mr. Modi's major flagship programs, whether it is the sanitation mission or it's any of the other things, smart city mission. What is that this kind of reform has to be anchored in behavioral change. In the sanitation mission, we've converted a project of the government into a project which through a Jan Andolan or a people's movement has become a project of the people. So I think that's where the change is. I don't think I need to say anything more on that for the simple reason that I have yet to come across any instance where anybody has come to me and said he went to a minister or somebody. First of all, you don't need to meet minister. I get what 40, 50 requests in a day where it's people who I think meeting them will help facilitate foreign investors, etc. I not only meet them, we have an agenda beforehand declared. I have officers of my ministry sitting there so that we don't have to say, okay, I'll get back to you. We're sitting there and we sort our problem. I do teleconferences on civil aviation once every few weeks with the states. We have the entire bureaucracy and the ministers sitting there here. We solve the problems on a real-time basis. What happens is, how do you change the mindset of the functionaire or the low level or somebody who thinks he's got a very important task to perform and who's weighed down by the sheer responsibility of it and then doesn't know how to deal with. Sometimes he or she are misunderstood as being negative in a different sense, but some of them probably are. So you have to deal with them. So when I get a complaint, I said, put it down on paper. Put it down on paper. I'm quite happy to, you know, give that person a chance to explain himself or herself and then just get it corrected. But let me tell you, it's getting much better. It's getting much better. I can give you an example, and I hope this is not being recorded by the press, but somebody will. My father had a small DDF flat. Many years, since he passed away many years ago, my brother and I have been finding it difficult to maintain it. We one day decided we want to sell it. But before you had to sell it, you had to have a mutation done from a... It's on his presses here, doesn't matter. Ashok is here. He won't quote it, don't worry. He's telling me you are here. No. No, it's an example which is a nice sort of an example. I was permanent representative in New York. I tried to speak to my friend, Mr. Bajal, the Lieutenant Governor. My brother used to speak to the person who was secretary in my ministry. Yes, hora. No, we can't find the papers, nothing else. It was not happening. It took us 5-6 years. Lo and behold, I became minister on 3rd September 2017. Within 10 days, they found my papers. They said, no, there was some problem. There's some inheritance certificate was missing or something. Nothing. Whatever was done. Today, everything is online, including in the land and development officers, this thing. I'm getting DDA completely digitized. That is the revolution. That you don't need to go to anyone from leasehold to freehold. That is the fundamental change taking place. Corruption, again, you said corruption, they face more at the state level than the center and down the line rather than the top. It's the same thing. But here again, I suspect it's the odd bod guy who indulges in a practice like this and gets everybody a bad name. My advice is, come, give us their names, and let's deal with it. Let's bring technology and transparency, let's put them to good use. Telecommunication, when 97% of your CEOs say that positive things are happening, I'm going to skip that. Labor, positive change, again, 75%. Your conclusion, three areas that require urgent attention from the respondents are infrastructure, land acquisition, and taxation. That broadly, I think, is correct. More attention doesn't mean that things are not happening there. You need to put it a little more. You need to give it a little more push. The four areas that do not need urgent attention, I disagree with you. It says bureaucracy, corruption, telecommunication, labor. You see, it's a question of nuancing it. I think that also needs attention. And it needs attention because you don't have to incentivize people. You have to make it clear that this is the norm. And any conduct which does not conform to the norm is an aberration which you regard as deviant, this thing. So I think we're all right there. Almost 3 out of every 5 CEOs said the government's Make in India and says brought change to the business leader. Now, you can put your Make in India, Assemble in India, I just want to say one thing to you. One of the functions of trade policy is also to ensure that the kind of economy that you get in the end. See, what is predatory pricing? As a young trade policy student, I was always saying, one used to be a little reckless and say, "Arre bhai, wo sasta bechna chahta to bechne do, consumer ka fayda hoga." Gosh, if it were true, I would say there's no harm in that. But it doesn't happen like that. What happens, whether it's airline pricing or manufacturing goods, if somebody does predatory pricing, he will continue the predatory pricing till the people who are manufacturing as per normal cost will be driven out of the market, and then the person has a monopoly, and then the price goes up. So as long as you can ensure that you're not destroying your fundamentals, it doesn't matter what you do. The fact of the matter is, Make in India is succeeding like anybody's business. I mean, I'll give you examples. We had no industry inserts of mobile handsets. Now you're one of the biggest in the world. So I would say it is good business sense for those who want to see changes tweaked, etc., and brought there. But for the other partner, it's not a question of being difficult. You have a responsibility to your own system. And I think all these things, I think, I'm not saying this because I'm Minister of State for Commerce and Industry, I think we're going about it slowly, surely, but the good news is that on the India-US front, nobody's telling me that we don't want to deal with trade. A, we want to deal with trade, we want to prepare the bilateral relationship both for the $5 trillion scenario and the $10 trillion scenario, and I think if things work the way they are working now, we are looking at the possibility of a much higher level of ambition on the trade and economic front than we've had so far. Thank you very much.
That should tell us, you know, that we should get into the manufacturing of APIs. So if we are to go 5 trillion and beyond that, I think healthcare segment is going to grow for all the times to come till the time life exists on this planet. So we in India are a pharmacy to the world. We can be pharmacy. APIs in a big way, otherwise it gets threatened. So my request is that if that sector can also be looked into very nicely, not only we create jobs, we create self-sustenance, but we also create billion dollars for all the world. Thank you.
Well, even if we were not sitting here, I would have told you, I've been saying for a long time that you cannot be building your pharmaceutical industry if you are so vulnerable and dependent on the import of active pharmaceutical ingredients, API. So I'm totally with you. I also belong to that old debate that took place on, during the Uruguay round, etc., where I said, look, the country has a responsibility not only to provide generics and, other things to itself, but you also have a responsibility to provide some of this to countries in Africa. And I can tell you, when I moved from I moved from London to Geneva, or rather from Geneva after my first posting to London. I spoke to some of the people, I think the name was Sipla Abdul Khalid. What was his name, Navdeep? Dr. Hamid. And they took to this whole business with great, efficiency. You had the Indian, they were taking it. To the point when we were threatened and saying that, there is infringement of intellectual property rights, etc. But that's all gone in the past. You know, today, public health, medicine, etc., those sections of society which require the thing within the country or in countries of Africa, it involves a higher level of moral this thing. I mean, if you leave it entirely to the the pharmaceutical countries of the world, look, they spend a lot of money in developing new drugs. But they are also, I think, realizing it. But someone else has to step in and fill that void.
That's something which I feel can be improved vastly and more can be done.
See, I think even our worst detractors will not deny the fact that we are a society anchored in the rule of law. You have your courts, you have your... But we're also very litigious people. I mean, across the country. I mean, some parts of India are more litigious than others, but that comes naturally as a habit, I suppose. But all I would say that what you are saying is correct. What you're looking for is process reform. I mean, much of what is, you know, gives rise to a frustration amongst our interlocutors or trading partners is the process requirement. You know, I mean, if you deal with a problem in the traditional method in which you've been dealing for 50 years, the person whom you're dealing with gets a little worried. I mean, that's why I keep saying there are ways and means of doing it in a different way. Find out why the guy is coming to see you. Ask him for the issues beforehand. Get your people sitting there. Have a roadmap ready for what? So he also thinks it's effective use of time. Otherwise, you know, a bureaucrat or a minister or anybody in political authority, their office is a place you go knocking and then, you know, other things happen. I think there's a fantastic amount of change which has taken place. As I said, for most issues relating to land permission, you don't need to see anybody. It's done all done online. I mean, you remember railway bookings, what it used to be at one stage. Today, everything is online. I mean, there'll be still some, et cetera. So that's the story everywhere, but I'll be the last one to, you know, to say that, no, we've arrived there. Not at all. We have a long distance to cover, but it's in the area of process reform, which I think.
So I'd like to add, I'd like to add to his question. I think what he's talking about is the legal processes in the law judiciary. It is a place where, in doing business rankings, we are the lowest.
I knew what he was, but it's probably not right for me on record. Process reform, I mean your judiciary as well. I mean, why is it that you got such long pendencies? Why are these things? Why is it? But you know, it's an ecosystem which is partly fueled by people who are not in the judiciary. There's a cozy arrangement which comes into being. But you know, as I said, this is all off the record. This part of it, I agree with you.
Please, ma'am.
My name is Dr. Preeti Jain, and I represent LanzaTech here. Very encouraging views, sir, from you, you know, on the aviation sector. Not just linked directly with ease of doing business, but our perspective, you know, how aviation sector is looking to go green, because everywhere in the world now, aviation sector is focusing to go greener. How Indian aviation sector, in your vision, is looking at it?
Look, insofar as the domestic sector going green, I don't think we'll be behind anyone. I don't anticipate any problem in that. Your problem will come in another area, which is that International Civil Aviation Organization, ICAO's, what is that thing called? That arrangement which they have.
CORSIA.
Thank you for reminding me. I should remember. But see, what happened is that they are working out their carbon limits, not on the basis of who's flying, but on artificial things. For instance, the Indian civil aviation, if you look at the number of Indian passengers who were traveling, let's say in the year reference point, let's say 2010, I have no problems. You can, as far as for the sake of an argument, you can peg it at the 2010 level. But on the other hand, they were Indian passengers. If it's defined in terms of Indians flying, I have no problem. But in terms of Indian airlines flying, Indian airlines are not flying those Indian passengers. It's airlines in other places who are flying them. I mean, I talked to the CEO of Singapore Airlines. He says, we need more flights. I said, how many do you have? You know, sir, we have 500 flights a week. I said, from how many places? 18. I said, how many more do you want? He said, sir, from China, we have 800 flights a week from 36 destinations. Now, if I look at how many people the Middle East countries fly, their carriers fly, etc. Now, I can't be penalized. I mean, they are flying. So if you say number of Indians flying in a plane, I have no difficulty, and we will match all that. So these are, you know, things in plurilateral or multilateral negotiations which happen, where we have to correct something which, you know, when CORSIA was adopted, we were upfront and you know, calling a spade a spade. But now it's a larger problem. Now other countries, you see, I come back to the same point. I mean, I give the example of the textile industry. I mean, a country which doesn't have any natural fibers or anything suddenly becomes a textile exporting country. I mean, I have case of a lot of Indians flying to a intermediate point, and there's six freedom rights being utilized. If you're not able to check that, your own civil aviation industry will never grow.
Last two questions, please. Yeah.
Sir, I'm Rajiv Sodhi. I have an incubator at IIT Delhi on machine learning, artificial intelligence. I wanted to file some patents around algorithms and software. And I was told by the IIT folks that it's very difficult to file patents. You can get copyrights. Unless you have equipments, it's difficult to file patents on algorithms and software.
Rajiv, all I can tell you is that copyrights is for, as you know, creative things, authorship, and so on. But if you're filing if you've got an invention or something which is this thing, you need to file a patent. I think the problem that you are referring to is on account of the fact that our patent office was for a long time was not properly manned. You didn't have people there. But I believe that's been corrected.
Can somebody give him the mic for the last question? In the meantime, sir, on the patent part, I must just alert you for your information. All the cutting edge companies, genetics, genetic engineering, AI, they are being told by their boards to shift base while filing patents either to Switzerland or to Singapore. Companies are doing it. And I think this is I can't even calculate the kind of loss that India will face, that you have done all the research here. The people doing the research want to do it for India, in India, but their boards, who are Indians, want them to, for safety protection, go to Singapore.
I am not only aware of this, I entirely endorse your assessment, but why certain people who have the economic power, who have the ability to take those decisions, decide to do it like that? I think we need a private discussion over a drink for me to give you the reasons, but they're not very flattering. I mean, that's...
Yeah. Last question, please.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Devjit. I'm from KPMG. So my question to you is that there's a lot of media reports that have come over the last few months that India has not really been able to take the advantage of supply chain disruptions that are happening in China and companies moving to different parts of the country, whether it is Vietnam or Thailand. Do you see this as a challenge right now?
No, first of all, unlike you, I mean, I'm a little older, you know, I mean, much older than you. And I have developed this healthy skepticism on what I read in the media. So, first of all, if somebody does some solid analysis based on case studies on what are the production lines which are being vacated in a country X, I'm not going into, you know, China or coronavirus. I'm not going. What are the production lines vacant? How many of you have been done? Nobody knows. You are operating in an environment where the deficiency, and I'm choosing my words very carefully, deficiency on data is so apparent. So I love situations where youngsters like produce a report like this. It's a damn good starting point. Whether this is how CEOs feel. I mean, if I were in this business, I would say 3 years from now, I'd say, hey, there were these guys who brought out this report. Let's do another one. Let's find out what has happened in the last 6 months or 3 years. Has it got better? Has it deteriorated? If so, why? Then you have a real discussion on your hands. But you know, somebody gets up in the morning and lagaos a news story, as I said, and much of this is also social media. Man, welcome to the world of social media. Somebody tells me, why, you know, you don't have enough followers. I said, my God, I've got enough trouble by sending serious one. If I start the frivolous kind of thing, no, it's a very simple thing. You know, dog bites man is not a story. Man bites dog is a story, and there'll be an interest.
This is specifically, you know, for Gautam. I don't know what his experiences are, but I am an IBMer, and I come from a company which has been filing the largest number of patents globally for the last 29 years.
I know.
And this year in India, you know, we have our research labs and all. We have filed 900 plus patents.
I know, but he's not referring to you. He's referring to Indian companies owned by Indians, where the research has been done by India, but the CEO or the owner says, "Don't file India, file in Switzerland." That's why I said. You guys are filing here. Look, number of patents being filed here, that is in the public record. He's pointing to another tendency. It's like when you go to a dinner in a Delhi. You know, the social elite here, and I haven't done that for a long time. You know, with great pride, the guy turns around and says, "Main apne bachyano kehta, bar settle ho ja." Hey, wait a minute. I mean, here is a guy who's made all his success in India, taken full advantage. He's fed off the Indian taxpayer, and yet has absolutely no hesitation in saying he wants his children to be settled abroad. I mean, children may decide to settle abroad because, you know, they're global citizens. That's a different issue. Here the guy saying, Gautam's point is that kind of point, where people who are in a decision-making thing, who are Indians, all the research is being done, they are saying, don't file here, you file outside. As I said, this is not a discussion we should have here, because I might say things which may be a little unkind to them.
I totally agree with you,
I agree with you.
And, you know, Gautam spoke about pains of doing business in the country through his report, and you tried to, you know, paint it in terms of, you know, ease of doing business, and these discussions are better done over Chatham House rules, over single malts.
Exactly.
We'll have meaningful outcomes.
Thank you very much, sir.